Hello, everybody. I am Mr. J, Coach J, and I always like to start my classes with a corny dad joke, and today's is as follows. What did the snowman do when the sun came out? Well, he was so upset he had a total meltdown. Ba-dum-bum. All right. If we can take two deep healing breaths together, preferably with your eyes closed, but however you are most comfortable. In through the nose, out through the mouth. You could do pizza breathing, cookie breathing, box breathing. It really doesn't matter. Just nice, slow inhales. And hold for a few seconds. That's what's going to decrease the heart rate, the blood pressure. One more time. Hold for a second and breathe out. These are some very, very simple things that people don't understand how crucial they are, just like sleep and water. People are like, yeah, breathe, eat, sleep, I got it. Well, they're pretty fundamental, but they're the building blocks of some serious healing. All right, so basically, this as usual with a lot of my classes, I like to stay very, very basic, very foundational. Happy to go into anything with questions or if we talk in person, whatever, but just because these classes go out to many people, I like to stay as basic as possible. So many of us have been through, recovery programs, know the pain and confusion of tackling one addiction only to have another one rear its head. And now this is if you yourself that are watching struggle with addiction, or you have somebody in your close circle that's struggling with addiction. And the reason for that is because when we stop an addictive behavior without getting to its root cause, the foundational problem remains. You may have stopped drinking, for example, if your addiction was drinking, but the cause still remains. So you must find other ways to cope. So, okay, let's just say something happened in your childhood and, you're using drugs, you're cutting, you're drinking, you're sexing, whatever it is your addiction is, whatever it is that you're numbing, distracting, you can stop that. But what happened in your childhood is still there. And if you don't deal with the foundational problem, the likelihood of going into another addiction is extremely high. That's why you may stop drinking and develop an eating disorder instead, because drinking itself was never the problem. It became a problem. It's like the top of the iceberg that we see above water. It's only 10% of the real thing. The issue is that 90% we don't see. How we coped with the problem with our unhealthy mechanisms was a problem. I mean, it's kind of three-layered. It's the issue at hand, our unhealthy coping mechanisms, and then the behavior of our unhealthy coping mechanisms. And a side note, this often explains affairs too. It's not the person that they were with that was so great in an affair, rather what the affair itself was able to do to the person that was in the affair, such as numb, distract, avoid, what have you. So it's interesting. A lot of people are like, what did he have that I didn't have? Or what did she have that I don't have? The ability to help your partner numb, distract, and avoid. It's probably about, it and availability and low morals, maybe, or whatever else you want to go with. Or bad coping mechanisms herself. I don't want to say low morals because I don't believe people that, and I can't believe I'm digressing, but I don't believe that people that have affairs are necessarily fundamentally bad. I just think they made a series of bad compromises, bad judgment calls. All right, addiction and trauma. When we grew up in with childhood trauma, developmental trauma, what have you, the pain we experience is overwhelming. And that's one of the definitions of trauma, is when something overwhelms our coping mechanisms. It's too much to bear, so we have to find ways to escape it. It's a dissociation of sorts. So trauma, in its simplest terms, and I've probably said this before, maybe you've heard this a thousand times, it's anything that overwhelms our coping mechanisms, which is why multiple people could experience the same exact thing and have different outcomes. To some people, they might be traumatized. Other people, they're not even fazed. It's whatever overwhelms our coping mechanisms. And of course, that has a lot to do with a lot of things, from attachment style to love language to what kind of examples did we have growing up, and what kind of environment did we have growing up, and what kind of tools and support systems did we have growing up? And, it gets into all kinds of mucky waters. Our addictions help us check out and dissociate from our real problems so we can function and go through life. Of course, we don't do well while under this control of addiction, but we survive or cope with our stress and manage with our overwhelm nonetheless. So, let's just say somebody has an addiction to self-pleasuring. Every time they are know they have to go to a family function, a work function, speak before a big crowd, their anxiety takes place. So they have to go run in the bathroom or whatever and quickly self-pleasure themselves or drink or cut or snort or whatever, people do. And then that kind of gives them that fix, that high, that sigh, that relax, that and then they can go and live life. So yes, in a way, it kind of helps you with your daily functions, but it's an extremely unhealthy way of dealing with your daily functions. So if you've experienced abuse and neglect in childhood, you go through life in almost a constant state of pain, not to mention hypervigilance. And sadly, these are the lenses that you will see through until you fix the root of the issue, which is why a lot of times when we come from developmental trauma or childhood trauma, so many of our relationships are struggle because we're looking through the lens of all of those wounds. I always tell people, when you send a text or read a text, which I'm like, Lord have mercy, you got to be very careful with text. We don't read what people write, we read how we interpret things. So we have to be very careful. And if we are always looking out of the lens of our wounds and injuries, that's what we're, the information that's going to come back. So I always tell my son, if you're always going to look for a reason somebody's giving you a dirty look, you will certainly find one. But if you always look for a reason why somebody might be looking at you, even if they have a scowl on their face, could be because they have a stomach ache. Could be because they're jealous that you have beautiful hair or something nice on. So whatever you look for, you will surely find, period. But you got to be careful because if we're looking through the lens of developmental trauma or abuse or dysfunction, that's the lens in which we're going to view our surroundings and whatever, and that's the information we're going to pull back into it as well. All right. You will have to develop, if you are going to work on this, you're going to have to develop an over-responsible and hyper-vigilant inner child. Tasked with keeping you safe. You're going to really have to do the psychological surgery necessary. And listen, we as a human, just as human beings, humans' evolutions, we want to run away from pain. The last thing we want to do is lead ourselves into the slaughterhouse. And a lot of times that's what it seems like we're doing when we seek out mental health. It's like, I don't want to face the demons of my past. And Lord knows I get it. Who wants to walk into the slaughterhouse? However, I always say, if you want to live comfortably, you have to temporarily get uncomfortable. All right. So basically, a lot of childhood trauma and developmental trauma and addiction, it steals our joy and it makes us feel as if we're all alone in a dangerous world. If you know the feeling of walking around with your shoulders around your ears and never being able to relax, you understand hypervigilance, which is why, not to derail, the first 3 or 4 months after D-Day, and for people that are watching and don't know what D-Day is, it's the day of discovery. This could be the discovery of whatever it is that completely flipped and turned your life upside down. You are hypervigilant about against everything. I mean, let's just say you found out your spouse or partner, significant other was having a fling with a teacher. Well, now it's like, every commercial, you're hypervigilant, especially if it's, a teacher saying, hey, it's flu season and this is what I give my students. Or if you see a billboard back to school, or if you are driving down the street and you see a school. I mean, like, there's nothing, it's like, I never saw a red car until a red car hit me, and now all I see is red cars. Anyways, back to what I was saying. Addictions give you an escape from the oppression of this type of existence. You use them as kind of a short-term benefits, even though the long-term consequences are well known to you. I mean, listen, we can snort up all we want. We can snort up all the eight balls. That's what they're called. I don't know. We want, and they'll give us a temporary fix. But what's going to happen in the long term is now we got some serious problems, because not only did we form an addiction that we have to deal with, but now we have all these other physiological and physical issues and stuff. Same with drinking, same with cutting. I mean, you know, people that cut to numb themselves or distract or whatever the case may be. Yeah, sure, you can cut a little here before a job interview just to cut down on your anxiety. But if that's your coping mechanisms, after a few years, there's not going to be sleeves long enough to hide all your cuts. So, I mean, it brings you you know, not to mention the lies and all this gaslighting and stuff that now you have to tell family, friends, and your inner circle members, you know, to hide from these addictions and stuff. So for this reason, addictions cannot be combated through logic or reason, just like affairs. There's some logic and reasons that can add to the components that led to certain things, but you can't address it with logic and reason. You can't make sense out of nonsense. Your survival brain feels as though it needs the addiction to survive. You never learned healthy coping mechanisms as a child. You only learned to defend yourself against threats by means of distracting, numbing, escaping. So again, it's a means of survival, you know, for a lot of these things. I always say addiction starts off as your best friend, but Lord have mercy, it turns into your worst enemy. But when you're alone and lonely and sad and confused and hurt and wounded, you need a friend, and you'll come to the first friend who gives you attention. What is that attention? Could be sex, could be drugs, could be alcohol, could be gambling, could be whatever the case is. So you adopted an unhealthy coping mechanism, or unhealthy coping mechanisms, plural, to get you through life the only way you knew how. You did not have the luxury of going to your parents for support, which made you believe you couldn't go to anyone for support, especially your primary attachments, your primary caretakers. Keep in mind that this is all while you're trying to navigate being a child, a teen, a young adult for the first time. I mean, you know, I was thinking the other day when I was looking at my son just turned into a teenager and he's starting to get some acne and stuff. And I was thinking, man, he's in middle school and now he's got acne and he's trying to fit in and he's probably getting interested in girls. I'm going to assume, because that's what he talks about. I can't imagine if he were in a very volatile home at the same token. Like, that's just too much overwhelm on his nervous system. Well, that's what a lot of kids go through. It's like they're trying to be a child and navigate all the firsts, you know, the first acne, the first crush, the first zero on a paper, and then have to come home and have no support system. It's overwhelming. It's overwhelming. And this is where you go to an escape. I always say affairs start in childhood. There's no such thing as, an affair started, very, very, very few times an affair happened by happenstance, you know, as an adult. Affairs start in childhood. Starts with your coping mechanisms, your attachments, what have you. Okay, I'm derailing yet again. One of the many reasons we may have acquired an addiction is we may have been punished for our wants and needs, you know, for speaking our mind or for having emotions. So you suppressed all of these, which makes simply living incredibly difficult. We could have been neglected, ignored, abandoned, abused, etc. Like I said, anything that overwhelmed our coping mechanism, addiction gives us a release valve from the oppression. I don't know if many of you remember the crock pots. Ooh, I'm aging myself. Actually, I don't even know if they're still around. I don't know. But so basically, it's, you know, you put that heavy metal thing on top, and man, once it starts screaming, you know, okay, what you got in there is either cooking or close to being done. Well, that's what happens with people that are in addiction, is they're taking that big metal piece off, and that steam's letting off. So whether you're going to visit your affair partner, you take that metal thing off. Whether you go and you self-pleasure, you go and you cut, you go and you drink, you go and you gamble, you go and you smoke, you go and you whatever, you're taking that relief valve off. You never learned that it was okay to take care of yourself. So instead, you use your addiction to create, a complete break with reality or give you some semblance of control of your situation. You know, what's very interesting is that we think we have control over our addictions, but it's interesting. Well, it's not interesting. It's kind of sad. They have control over us. So, let's just say somebody is an addict to porn. So yeah, you can type in whatever it is you're into. I'm into werewolves that eat corn at midnight and have sex. I mean, what? And you're in control of what you put on the screen because you type it. You're in control. You can type, I want a black wolf and a gray wolf, and then that's what you see. And next thing you know, obviously, well, I don't even know if there is porn with wolves. I'm just making things up to get whatever. But you are in control, so it's giving you a sense of control. But are you really in control? And that's the thing with addiction. The same thing with cutting, with anything that we use as a coping mechanism. We think, hey, I'm in control of when I cut my arm, how deep I cut my arm, where I cut my arm. Really? Okay, because that doesn't sound like control to me. But that's what it gives us, a false sense of control. However, if we've been molested or raped or abused or whatever the case is in any way, shape, or form in our past, and somebody stole consent and control, that's what we want sometimes with addictions. We want to feel like we're in control. Which is why, and I said I was going to keep this 101, but I guess I'm not. Which is why, unfortunately, a lot of things happen in our past that was absolutely horrific, disgusting, and unacceptable. And we know that. I'm talking about an addict. And yet they'll go and do the same exact thing. And one of the reasons why is because they're trying to recreate a scenario where they weren't in control of before that now they're in control of. Because now you're older and you have different coping mechanisms and things like that. So you might be saying, well, this hap I, how could you do this? It happened to you. Well, because it happened to them when they didn't have the tools and the resources to be in control, now they actually repeated that behavior when they're at a different point in their life. So they did feel like they have control. It gets complex. Okay. However, like I said before, it's a false sense of control because in reality, we're not in control of the drinking or the porn or the snorting or the whatever. It's actually in control of us. And the longer we do it and the longer we use it as a coping mechanism, it now really digs a deeper neural pathway in our brain and stuff. So it just is harder to get away from. The longer we're in it. I always say, man, addiction takes you further away than you want to go and keeps you longer than you want to stay. So, to the best of our abilities, we shouldn't open that door. And we certainly shouldn't give any focus to any of the impulses that lead us into addictive behavior if we're trying to get out. Okay, I'm going to keep this 101. Sorry. Anyways, that's why anyone who quits or attempts to quit an addiction without addressing the underlying issues, which is what I said before, tends to relapse. That may be a reason the 12-step programs have a poor recovery rate. Although, don't get me wrong, oh my God, please don't send me letters and curse me if you're in a 12-step program, because 12-step programs are tremendously supportive, and I think that's what helps their success. You have a and you need support no matter what we're going through. We need support, so there's success in that. But other than the support, and don't get me wrong, there's other components that are very helpful. The relapse when it comes to 12 step, there's a higher percentage. All right. Isolation only worsens our problems, getting back to the whole 12 step thing. So we don't want to isolate ourselves because that worsens. I always say bacteria thrives in warm, moist areas. You close a bathroom door, it is warm and moist, and bacteria what is going to thrive in there. You open up the door and let the sun shine in. Not only is that bacteria going to stop growing, it's also going to start receding after a while. And that's why the 12-step programs are helpful in the fact that people don't feel isolated, because our struggles are only as big as our secrets, and our addiction is only as big as our secrets. So once you let that secret out of the bag, it really kind of by 50% automatically initially drops, reduces that. All right. Before ending this class, and Lord knows I've been all over the board, but what else is new? It's ADHD for you. Before ending this class, I want to give you a few quick tips on how to start addressing addiction. Now, obviously, this is complex, multi-layered, what have you, but just, you know, a few tips just in case somebody's watching and they're like, I don't even know where to begin. Number one, you have to admit that you have an addiction. That, you know, I mean, the hardest part of recovery is admitting that you have a problem. After all, you cannot change what you don't acknowledge. You know, I mean, if you weigh 750 pounds and you'd say, I don't have a weight problem, you're not going to address it. You don't have a weight problem. Reflect on your addiction. What does that mean? You know, before you even get into any type of mental health professional, why don't you say, okay, where could have been the onset of this? What was the foundation of this? What were some components that led to this? Now, be very careful where you're digging, especially without a professional mental health professional, because you also need the support. But you could start thinking, you know what? Yeah, I think when I needed my parents when I was younger, when I got home from school, I understand they were working. I do understand they were working, and I understand they both had to work. But man, I felt neglected. And I think because of that neglect, I went and searched for this on the computer. And then I found this. And then, yeah, that might make sense. Not to blame anyone, but just to kind of reflect and start getting to the roots of things. Obviously, seek professional help, you know, whether that's a coach or counselor, whatever the case is. And if you can't look into any of those, or you're not comfortable with any of those, or you don't want to do any of those, or you can't afford any of those, then my God, get a book, get a workbook, listen to podcasts, watch videos. There's all kinds of things you can do. Appreciate the benefits of sobriety. When I mean sobriety, I mean sobriety from self-pleasure, the sobriety from drinking, the sobriety from even people-pleasing can be an addiction. Make sure you try to find evidence-based care to the best of your ability. But listen, any care you can find is good. Just be very careful, because you could have what's called T trauma. That's therapeutic trauma. That's people who have no clue what they're doing. And it leaves you walking away feeling more anxious and traumatized than before you met the person. And that can be difficult. I'm not going to get into that now, but that could be difficult. Make sure you identify your triggers. What are your triggers? Now, obviously, if you're still in the acute stages of post-betrayal or finding out about, you know, whatever it is you're wanting to work on, that could be hard, because everything's a trigger. Everything's a trigger, especially if you're reconciling with the person. They're a walking, talking, breathing trigger. But try to identify your triggers to the best of your ability, especially long-term, so you can really start working on halting those triggers and things like that. Change your environment. I mean, you know, listen, if you have to sell the car, because that's a trigger, if you have to sell the house and move, if you can afford it and if you can do it, if you have to rearrange your bedroom, whatever you need to do, change your environment. You don't want to be forced to marinate in an environment that's full of triggers. Do what you can. There's going to be things you can't do possibly, but do what you can. Make sure you exercise. I can't tell you, man, exercise is just so good physiologically, psychologically, emotionally, just it's good. The last thing I want to say is just one little technique I give the people that I work with that are struggling with addictions is the traffic light. So basically there's three circles. What are the green light, make three circles. You can even do it in like a Venn diagram situation. This is green. So what is green for you? Oh, well, watching soap operas, go skiing, showering, you know, whatever. Okay, what's a red zone? Red zones are things that you got to be, they might be okay, but you got to be safe. Talking to my sister, because she's always so full of drama. Going down this one street, because there's, you know, whatever. These are danger zones where you got to be very vigilant when you're doing. And then these are the red things. Well, what are the red things? Going places and purposely not telling your spouse where you're going. Going down streets where you used to meet your drug dealer. You know, so those are red zones, and those you got to stay away from things. So, you know, just a few little tips and techniques to help start addressing some of your addictions. Most importantly, we have to replace old unhealthy coping mechanisms with healthier ones. Listen, I tell people all the time, if you smoke, even cigarettes, and you want to stop, you not only have to address the physiological addiction, the psychological addiction, but the physical addiction. If the first thing you do in the morning is like, you know, oh, I need to light up. Okay, well, you have memory in your hands, in your mouth, in your lips, because you're doing this movement. Not to mention the nicotine as an addiction, or whatever else is an addiction, in cigarettes that are addicting. What are you now going to replace what you're doing with your hands and your mouth in this? So it really has to be an all-encompassing milieu if you're going to work on an addiction, which is why you need to find somebody who's kind of, you know, mindful, and has some understanding of addiction like that. Anyways, I know in a lot of this class, I barely scratched the surface, but I did want to give you some information on how to cope with stress, trauma, and addictions, or with addictions, and some ways we can start to address it. So I hope you did get something out of this. And if you didn't, then I hope you appreciate my corny dad joke.